của đài VBS Canada, Diễm Hương đang có mặt ở Holly Blossom Temple. Nhóm Voice Canada đã cùng hợp tác với cộng đồng người Do Thái để tổ chức một buổi lễ kỷ niệm và vinh danh một cái người nhân vật rất là quan trọng với cộng đồng người Việt chúng ta, đó là Professor Howard Alderman. Ông là người đã đứng ra kêu gọi bảo trợ cho người Việt tị nạn, những người thuyền nhân tị nạn người Việt của chúng ta vào từ năm 1979. Và cái Lifeline Operation của ông đã giúp được rất nhiều người tị nạn của Việt Nam chúng ta định cư ở Canada. Và bên cạnh đó, chúng tôi được biết là có một số những người bảo trợ người tị nạn cũng có mặt tại buổi lễ ngày hôm nay. Xin quý vị cùng theo dõi chương trình phóng sự ngày hôm nay với chúng tôi. Kính thưa quý vị, Diễm Hương tìm được một gia đình người Việt. Chị đã được bảo lãnh của một gia đình người tốt bụng người Canada vào những năm trước. Và giờ Diễm Hương xin phỏng vấn chị vài câu. Thưa chị Huyền, em được biết là gia đình chị tới đây đã được một cái sự bảo trợ giúp đỡ từ người Canadian. Thì không biết chị có thể kể lại cái hoàn cảnh lúc đó làm sao mà chị tới đây bằng năm nào và gặp những khó khăn gì và được bảo lãnh như thế nào. Thì có thể có sơ sơ vài câu cho tụi em biết được không?
Gia đình tôi tới đây năm 1980, được một cái hội nhà thờ ở Do Thái lãnh. Nghe kể lại là tối đêm mấy ngày trước đó, nhìn thấy cái tàu vượt biên mà bị cướp, bị chết ở trên biển. Nên những người này cảm động nên mới là sponsor cho gia đình tôi ở đảo.
Vậy bao nhiêu lâu chị ở với lại người bảo lãnh?
Những người bảo trợ này lo cho gia đình tôi 1 năm.
Vậy đây là người đứng bên cạnh chị, có phải là người bảo trợ chứ không? Dạ, dạ. Thưa Mr. David Hart, my name is Lisa and we with VBS Canada. And we were told in Vietnamese that Miss Nguyen, she was sponsored by you and your family back then.
There were a few other families too.
Okay.
What Temple had a fund, and we got 8 people to look after.
Okay.
And we had 4 families with us.
Oh, okay.
And we all worked together.
Oh, okay. So what make you, you know, like feel for the Vietnamese refugees and stand out and sponsor them? Like what make you do that?
Well, Temple decided that they wanted to help. And they asked for volunteers, and here I am. But I, you know, it's something I would have liked to have done on my own anyhow, because I just felt so strongly about what was happening, you know, the whole situation for them.
So after you sponsor them and get to know a lot more Vietnamese people, do you? How do you feel about the war, Vietnamese war, and the fact that a lot of Vietnamese had to escape the country to go to another country to rebuild their life?
Look, it's difficult. Over the 30 years time, almost 30 years, it was 1980 when they came, and there's another chap, he and I went out house hunting. And we had a heck of a time because nobody wanted to rent for 8 people in a small house. But we finally found a man who was helpful, and he rented us his building. Do you remember? And I approached members of the congregation, and we got furniture donated. And by the time they arrived, we had the house with furniture all ready for them.
Okay. So thank you very much for sharing with us your story. And we really appreciate all your help for the Vietnamese people, refugees. And now we can see that she has been here more than 30 years and she has a new life. I think it's, you know, we will ask her one more question and you know, truly.
I'd like to ask her one, too.
Sure.
What happened to your parents that lived in King City?
Oh, they come here. They come. Everybody come to Toronto now. Yeah.
So you're all together?
Yeah, all together.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
So, as you say, như quý vị vừa mới thấy là cái câu chuyện này rất là cảm động vì những người Do Thái họ rất là có một cái sự họ ông nói là ông feels very strongly, nghĩa là ông cảm thấy rất là cảm động trước cái sự vượt biên và khó khăn của những người Việt tị nạn thời đó, và ông đã cùng với 8 người nữa giúp bảo trợ 8 người gia đình của chị Huyền Nguyễn, và bây giờ họ đã được đoàn tụ. Đây là một cái câu chuyện rất là cảm động, và cảm ơn cộng đồng Do Thái nói chung và ông David Hart cũng như những người trong chùa của ông nói riêng. Thank you so much, sir.
You're welcome. I'm glad I was able to do it.
Thank
they
you.
Were so helpful. They were great.
Thank you.
Ông có 3 người con á, là luật sư nè, hai người trẻ đó, tới nhà chị mỗi tuần 2 ngày để dạy cho mấy đứa em này nó học Anh văn với lại nó học mấy cái môn nào mà yếu.
Bây giờ những em đó đã lớn và đã thành tài phải không ạ?
Thành tài hết, đứa dược sĩ với lại nhỏ con gái dạy qua chị cũng thành tài hết.
Chị có thể nói một câu gì với ông không?
Thank you very much.
David.
Hải, và Diễm Hương xin hỏi ông một vài câu nhân cái kỷ niệm ngày hôm nay là buổi lễ mà chúng ta thấy có những nhiều người bảo trợ với những gia đình người Việt tị nạn đã được bảo trợ vào những năm 79-80 lúc trước đây. Thưa chú, cháu muốn hỏi chú là trước cái sự cảm động của những gia đình người Việt Nam tị nạn gặp gỡ lại những người bảo trợ của họ năm xưa, thì chú có cái cảm giác như thế nào?
Tôi xin chào cô và chào khán giả của đài VBS. Tôi nhận đây là một cái cơ hội mà chúng ta ôn lại cách đây 40 năm. Từ 75 chúng ta bỏ xứ ra đi, xong rồi 79 một cái đoạt cái lượt mà thuyền nhân của chúng ta bỏ ra đi để mà trốn chạy cộng sản, thì tôi thấy rằng đây là một cái kỷ niệm mà chúng ta không thể nào quên được. Cái thứ nhất, cái thứ hai đó, những người mà bảo trợ chúng ta đó, họ vẫn còn tại đây nữa. Cái đó là một cái mà tôi thấy đó là một cái hãnh diện mà chúng ta nên cảm ơn họ và bày tỏ cái sự kính trọng đó đối với họ. Và cái thứ ba mà chúng ta phải làm là bây giờ cái dân mà Syria hiện nay họ cũng chung một cái cảnh của người Việt của chúng ta ngày xưa. Thì đây là cũng là cái lúc mà cộng đồng người Việt của chúng ta cũng nên là ra tay để mà đóng góp và bảo trợ lại những người tị nạn Syria. Tuy nhiên nó cũng có vài một số chuyện mà chúng ta cần phải làm, không phải đơn giản như hồi ngàn trên năm 79. Tôi hy vọng rằng với chính phủ của ông Trudeau mà ông nói rằng ông sẽ nhận 25.000 người từ đây cho tới cuối năm, tôi hy vọng rằng ông sẽ làm được công việc đó mà không phải bỏ qua những cái độ giai đoạn phải nghĩa là về vấn đề an ninh vân vân. Và chúng tôi cũng hy vọng rằng ông Trudeau đã nói là ông sẽ bỏ ra khoảng 250 triệu để lo cho những người tị nạn Syria, thì tôi hy vọng rằng ông phải giữ cái lời hứa đó, và hy vọng rằng cái lời hứa của ông, thì tôi đối với thượng nghị sĩ của Canada, tôi sẽ nhắc nhở ông hoài về cái câu hứa của ông.
Như vậy chúng ta thấy là trong 40 năm qua chúng ta đã mang ơn những người đã giúp đỡ cho cộng đồng người Việt nói chung. Thì bây giờ đã đến lúc mà chúng ta cũng nên suy nghĩ chúng ta có thể làm được gì cho những người Syria, cũng là những người tị nạn và có những cái hoàn cảnh khó khăn như chúng ta cách đây mấy chục năm trước. Và có lẽ như là thượng nghị sĩ nói là bây giờ chính phủ mới đã có một cái quyết định là sẽ nhận 25.000 người, thì chúng ta đã vote cho ông, thì hy vọng là ông sẽ giữ đúng cái trách nhiệm và cái lời hứa đó để giúp cho cái công việc đó được thực hiện.
Tôi hiểu, bởi vì là đó là cái mà khi mà ông Trudeau ra tranh cử thì ông đã hứa rằng ông sẽ đem vô 25.000 người Syria và ông sẽ bỏ ra khoảng 250 triệu để lo cái vấn đề tị nạn đó. Thì tôi hy vọng rằng dân Canada đã bỏ phiếu cho ông và ông đã đắc cử, và tôi hy vọng rằng ông Trudeau vẫn phải giữ cái lời hứa của ông là phải công nhận 25.000 người Syria. Tuy nhiên không nên bỏ qua những cái giai đoạn về an ninh quốc gia. Tóm lại, tôi rất đồng ý cái chuyện mà chúng ta đóng góp để mà nhận người tị nạn Syria. Và đây là cũng cái cơ hội chứng tỏ cho những người mà bảo trợ chúng ta lúc trước thấy rằng cộng đồng người Việt chúng ta đã mang ơn đền đáp lại và đã đứng lên bảo trợ lại những người Syria của chúng ta.
Cảm ơn Thượng nghị sĩ rất nhiều đã chia sẻ với đài VBS Canada về những chương trình như vậy.
Dạ, tôi xin cảm ơn cô và xin cảm ơn các khán giả của đài VBS.
Vị bên cạnh Diễm Hương là ông Bộ trưởng Bộ Di trú vào những năm 1979-80, ông Ron Arkey. Ông là người đã giúp cho Lifeline Operation được thực hiện. Và Diễm Hương xin có a few words in English với ông. Hello, Mr. Arkey. My name is Lisa, and with VBS Canada.
Lisa, I'm pleased to be here.
And we, as a Vietnamese community, owe you a big thank you for all your help in 1979-1980, when you are still the Minister of Immigration, and you helped to launch the Lifeline Operations.
That's correct.
And accept a lot of, like, how many people that you accept?
There were 60,000 people over a year and a half.
60,000 people, Vietnamese refugee in a year and a half. Rất là a big number. So do you have any difficulties at that time?
Just getting enough airplanes and getting enough military barracks so people had a place to stay for the first few days. But we were overwhelmed by support from the community. People wanted to provide housing and settlement funds and assistance. So it was just getting enough planes to get the people over here quickly and to get them to adjust to Canadian winter.
So before that, do you know anything about the Vietnamese people and the world and the environment where they have to live, like and the reason why they have to escape?
Yes, I understood the political situation from 1975 with the fall of Saigon, and the difference between the north and the south and the intolerable conditions for the people in the south, and having to flee in order to save their lives and. We were very happy to provide assistance.
Thank you very much, and we are very happy to see you here today, and we hope that we still continue to have your support.
Okay, most certainly you have my support. You've been a great addition to our community. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Việc bảo trợ đã bùng lên, lan sang các đơn vị bên cạnh. Cộng đồng Việt Nam lúc đó ở trong câu các ông Nghiêm Phú Phúc, Đỗ Trọng Trung và Trần Trung Lương đã tiếp xúc với giáo sư Adamant và bạn bè của ông, phát triển lớn việc bảo trợ thành một tổ chức quy mô mang tên Operation Lifeline. Đơn vị khởi đầu là St. Paul thuộc miền Tây Toronto và ngay sau đó quả rộng khắp nước. Đây là đơn vị của danh biểu Ron Arkey. Ông Arkey lúc đó là Bộ trưởng Di trú của chính phủ Joe Clark thuộc đảng Progressive Conservative. Phong trào bảo trợ này do sự tổ chức và gọi cộng với lòng tin của người tị nạn Việt Nam đã thành công hết sức tốt đẹp như chúng ta đã thấy. Nhiều người trong chúng ta đã biết đến niềm rất hạnh phúc này là do công ơn của hai anh em có tâm hồn lớn và yêu cầu tâm hồn nữa này và cộng đồng Do Thái. Đêm hôm nay chúng ta sẽ có một bài phát biểu.
Our home and native land. moment of silence. As today is Remembrance Day, this moment of silence is of greater significance as we honor the brave men and women who lay down their lives in the name of freedom. Xin quý vị tiếp tục đứng trong phút mặc niệm vì hôm nay là ngày lễ tưởng niệm. Thì thời điểm im lặng này sẽ có ý nghĩa lớn hơn khi chúng ta tôn vinh tất cả các phụ nữ và người đàn ông dũng cảm từng hy sinh mạng sống của mình cho hai chữ tự do.
And we knew what it felt like to be without a place to really call a lasting home. In 1984, our own Rabbi W. Gunter Plaut of blessed memory, who was himself a refugee from the land of his birth in Germany, he was, in 1984, invited by the Canadian government to revise refugee legislation. Rabbi Plaut's 221-page report on refugee determination in Canada began with a personal introduction. He wrote then, I was a refugee once, having fled from Hitler under whose rule I had lived for more than 2 years. I know the heart of the refugee, a person who desperately seeks for a place to stand, for the opportunity to be accepted as an equal among fellow humans. I belong to the fortunate ones whose quest has been generously answered. My personal experience and my own religious tradition have moved me to put on Canada's national agenda the larger issues that arise from a consideration of refugees and their problems. When Rabbi Plaut speaks of the religious tradition, he's referring to our sacred book of the Torah, where 36 times more than any other commandment, it is written that we must treat the stranger well, that we should always be on the lookout for the foreigner, for the asylum seeker, for the refugee, for the resident alien, for the one who is somehow not quite yet at home. Holy Blossom Temple is Toronto's first synagogue, founded in 1856, and ever since its founding, we have been on the lookout for the stranger, for the one who is in need of a home. Oftentimes, throughout the decades, initiatives were taken up to welcome in Jewish immigrants from lands virtually from every continent. But not only Jewish immigrants and Jewish refugees, also non-Jewish refugees, because it is our sacred duty to do so. And not only to do so, but to do so joyfully. It is written in our Torah that this is a commandment, a sacred obligation that must be fulfilled joyfully, not grudgingly, not sparingly, but with a whole heart. And that has been our privilege time and time again. So tonight we honor Professor Howard Adelman and many in the room who joined him in this initiative decades ago. Let me please ask anyone from the Jewish community who was involved in sponsoring Vietnamese refugee families, would you please rise? Share our stories informally with one another as well. welcome, and thank special thanks to James and to Lee for this good idea, for coming to me over the summer, introducing Howard, introducing them to me so that we could make this occasion. Thank you.
Enabling 50,000 Vietnamese refugees to Canada
in response to the refugee crisis.
Join you to pay tribute to my friend Howard Abelman. I'm going to be very brief today and share with you just two memories of that pivotal time in 1979, 1980 when major commitments were made. The one is a story that has been told many times, but it's worth telling again. When we were as a new government in June of 1979 debating what to do about the increasing crisis of the boat people in Southeast Asia, and numbers were being thrown around, and commitments were being suggested. We knew we wanted to do more, but there were doubters. I was given a text of a manuscript of a book to be published by former colleagues at York University called Harold Troper and Irving Abella. The book is called None Is Too Many. And that book told the sorry tale of Canada's failure to do its part for Jewish refugees in 1938. And it's a story that had profound impact on me and on colleagues in cabinet, as I shared with them the general thrust of that story. And I can tell you it had a significant impact on the decision of the government of the day on July 18th. Just 6 weeks after we were in government, to commit to 50,000 refugees coming into Canada. That's story number one. Story number two, to make 50,000 people happen in terms of refugees, those in government came up with this idea, and it's been around for a while, that the private sector should contribute, and there should be a matching program. And that for every government-sponsored refugee, there should be one sponsored by the private sector. And there were doubters in our cabinet and within the government and with the media at that time. But there was a program designed by a previous government, and it did provide for private settlement. And there were groups in the community across Canada, but particularly in the middle of the St. Paul's riding, right where we're located now. And there was this fellow called Howard Eagle. Started in our circumstances, an Operation Lifeline. And that was the beginning of the organic growth of private sector settlement sponsorships, which were really the success of the entire program. Matter of fact, it was so successful that the private sponsorships outnumbered the government sponsorships of refugees. And the number eventually had to be increased from 50,000 to 60,000 by the end of 1980. And so I want to say very much thank you, Howard, for your group and for being a representative of the organic part of what is really good about Canada Day. Private citizens, faith groups, municipalities, individuals, neighborhoods, communities coming together and doing what's right, and that's the Canadian way. Thank you, Howard, for your time.
Les réfugiés syriens ont touché le cœur des Canadiens d'une mère à l'autre. C'est pourquoi nous sommes donc réunis aujourd'hui pour nous rappeler que le Canada est une terre d'accueil avec des valeurs humanitaires qui célèbrent fièrement son multiculturalisme. I believe this honorable event at the Holly Blossom Temple is yet another occasion to commemorate an important chapter of Canada's human compassion in welcoming 60,000 refugees in the island that followed the Fort Simon and the Walking Boy Exodus. The lesson learned from the Walking Boy Exodus as the biggest refugees crisis in the 20th century can now be applied to the biggest refugees crisis in the 21st century. We are currently witnessing with millions of refugees fleeing Syria. Canada's grassroots response during the World People Exodus was stunning. Across the country, local leaders like Ottawa Marion Doerr and York University Dr. Howard Alderman, who we are honoring tonight, set up organizations like Project 4000 and Operation Lifeline that channeled concern of Canadians for the refugees into the new sponsorship program. I was personally proud when I learned the plan for Operation Lifeline were hatched in Howard Adams' living room. And that these plans have now expanded into renewed and combined effort of our communities and many others to help the cause of the refugees, like Voice Canada, for instance, and who accomplished tremendous work for the cause of the refugees. As we face the tragic new of the Syrian refugees crisis, we must remember that some of us were in those exactly shoes 40 years ago. Some Syrian refugees are escaping the devastating effect of civil war, brutal dictatorship, like thousands of Vietnamese refugees who had to escape their war-torn home and communist oppression 40 years ago. It is our turn to give back by mobilizing our communities and others to support the Syrian refugees. With your help, I think we can make our journey to freedom their story too. Now Canada comes to a new government with the new humanitarian plan to help the refugees crisis. As a senator, I plan on ensuring that this new government doesn't cut corners to expand Canada's intake of refugees from Syria by 25,000 through immediate government sponsorship. Also invest $250 million, including $100 million this fiscal year, to increase refugee sponsorship, processing, as well as sponsorship resettlement services capacity in Canada. I would like to make that accountable for that. But whatever approach the government undertakes, let's remember that it's Canadian compassion that truly makes a difference in accepting these refugees and seeing that they become part of the Canadian family. I wish to commend the Vietnamese Canadian and the Jewish Canadian communities for taking up the torch and acting as a beacon of true human compassion. Your direct involvement in helping the Syrian families start new lives in Canada. What I hear on the Parliament Hill, we have a lot of work to do coming up to help arriving refugees. Before I conclude, I should say that it is an honor for us, for all of us, to be with Professor Alderman, who has been a well-known force in leading not only the Congress who are generously hosting us tonight, but also by encouraging everyday Canadian in supporting the cause, in listening to the plight of the refugees. Je tiens à remercier les organisateurs de cette soirée ainsi que nos hôtes généreux du fond du cœur pour un événement qui rayonne les leçons apprises et le vécu de nos communautés. Cet héritage commun représente une de nos plus grandes forces, une que nous allions partager avec nos concitoyens et les nouveaux réfugiés. Thank you again for inviting me to be part of this initiative, where we can learn from one another. Let me once again thank our dear host, Rabbi Spansky, for making this temple available to us and to meet and exchange ideas. I think the Jewish hospitality and the Vietnamese dessert make an excellent combination.
Is that true, Professor? Somewhat? I truly believe that it's through his philosophy, education, and his love of reading that the former professor's worldview, and thus his legacy in helping others, such as our own Vietnamese boat refugees. I wonder what would have happened if Professor Edelman had become a doctor. Surely he would have made a great doctor, but then what would have happened to Operation Lifeline? I previously mentioned Professor Edelman's brother, Dr. Alan Edelman. During the time the boat refugees were arriving in Toronto, Dr. Alan Edelman and his colleagues at Mount Sinai Hospital and Sick Kids Hospital made sure that for the first few months, the boat refugees would receive the required help free of charge. Unfortunately, we are not here to say thank you to Alan Edelman, as he died about 20 years ago. For me, people like Professor Edelman and his brother has inspired me and many countless others within the Vietnamese community to want to help those who are in need. Under the leadership of Voice Canada, I am one of many sponsors that brought over 67 stateless Vietnamese refugees from Thailand last fall and winter. I believe some of them are actually in the crowd here today. And now our same group will be continuing this legacy by raising money and finding sponsors to help the Syrian refugees. My friend, Li Luang, we'll talk a little bit more about this project later in this program. I'm also proud to announce that Thai Báo newspaper, the biggest Vietnamese newspaper in the country, will be launching the Howard Edelman Community Award. This award will be given to someone from the Vietnamese community that best exemplifies Professor Edelman's humanitarian work. I would like to recognize, I think, Mr. Nick Do and Mr. Quang Nguyen, who will be on the selection committee with myself and Professor Edelman. Please stay tuned for more information about this award, as it will be awarded sometime next year. And now, I would like to invite two longtime friends of Professor Edelman from the Vietnamese community to come up, as they would like to present something to Professor Edelman on behalf of Voice Canada, Mr. Peter Tran and Mr. Phuc Nguyen Phu. Joining these two gentlemen will be Grace Doe, the young lady that sang the National Canadian Anthem, whose grandfather, John Doe Jung Chu, was instrumental with these two gentlemen in working with Professor Edelman to help a lot of the Vietnamese boat refugees. Professor, please come up. So can you say a couple of words?
Yeah. It is Remembrance Day. And one of the things that I try never to forget, and remember it often, is that there are at least 200,000 Vietnamese who fled Vietnam who never made it, who drowned at sea. And that should not be forgotten. There are a number of other people, some who passed away, like John Chu, who was very important, who was a former alderman in Saigon, who was involved with Operation Lifeline at the beginning in the Truth of Man. There's Wendy Chaloux, who ran Operation Lifeline, who lives in Baltimore and can't be here. There's Joseph Wong, who would have liked to be here as a doctor and had physician duties tonight. There are all kinds of other people. Hesh Tropa was mentioned earlier. Hesh, would you stand up? Hesh is all of them. Influential, as Ron Atkey said, and he was at my house the second day and became I can't remember what job he took on, but he took on one of the jobs we were handing out. there are the friends I've made in the Vietnamese community. Peter Tran is here. I was looking today for, there's a picture of myself and Peter at his, when he opened his restaurant, and we were looking for, we couldn't find it, so we're going to have to get to you to find it. There are so many people. It was a very much a group effort. And there are a few myths about the effort. The biggest part was played by Ron Atkins. Ron took a brave and courageous stand to initiate for large numbers. And without his leadership, it wouldn't be there. And I'll just tell you one story, I've told it many times. It was a Sunday when we were having that meeting and we were planning to write a strong letter to Ron, who is our member of parliament, to bring more refugees. And somehow, I don't know still today how we heard about the meeting, but he sent two top civil servants to knock at my door and ask if they could join the meeting. And they were the ones that suggested we sponsor refugees instead of just writing a letter. So it came in all kinds of ways, the leadership of the government, that inspired us to respond to that leadership and that made such a big difference. Lastly, I'd like to talk about all kinds of people. For example, Rabbi Splansky mentioned Rabbi Bielefeld and Temple Emmanuel. Temple Emmanuel, which is a smaller synagogue than Holy Blossom, sponsored 100 refugees at the time. And we should thank them. When the people from one of the young people from Temple Emmanuel, who was a speechwriter for president that I will not mention, was one of the activists, the most important, I think, activists at the time, very active in helping in the Temple Emmanuel. That's David Frum. There's also people like Naomi Alcorn. We should stand up, Naomi. I could go around this room and spot a number of people from this temple itself. Fred Siemens is somewhere, I think, in the audience. My oldest point is that I was one element of a big collective effort, and it was a Canadian effort, and it's a Canadian effort to take the initiative. And it's being repeated today and being led by the government now. And I hope we'll all respond with passion, compassion, and our own efforts. Thank you very much.
To invite the President of Voice Canada and the Vice President of Voice Canada, Mr. Tian Do and Mr. Tuan Li, to come up and give an award to a very significant person. Professor just mentioned him, Professor Fred Siemens, past president of Holy Blossom Temple. Because he gets very emotional, so after 10 seconds, Professor, you're done. Joking aside, I heard that Professor Fred Siemens is devoted to social justice and just the love for people, and we're honored, Professor, to have you here. We're honored to say thank you to the Holy Blossom Temple community. So I have the President of Voice, and we'd like for you to say a couple words.
I'd like to say that this is a gift of the Vietnamese overseas community, and it's presented not only to Holy Blossom, but to the Jewish community. And I told my kids I wouldn't cry, but... it was an incredible opportunity which we took, and that was the commitment of Jews to be there to deal with social justice. And it was something that is very much built into our religion. And many of the people in this room were all involved in this, and we have learned how to reach out to other communities. So I thank the Vietnamese community, and this evening is an incredible event, and it's really something that we should all be very proud of.
Vì không muốn làm kẻ tội đồ,
also means they freedom is something that you train your tears and blood for, and that was the chorus line I repeated throughout the song, and that's resonating with many of us. So for the next portion, I would like to invite one of the Jewish families here that made freedom possible for us, and this is David Hartzman, who at the time was a young leader within the Holy Blossom Temple community, and she's made it possible for the refugees to, yes, the Hartzman family.
My name's David Hartzman. A little while ago, Rabbi Splansky called and asked if I could share some memories of my experience with the boat people in 1979. Rabbi Fields was the head rabbi at the time, and his assistant was Rabbi Mark Dove Shapiro, who with his lovely wife Marcia were close friends of ours. It was Rosh Hashanah 5740, High Holidays 1979, in the Eisendrath Auditorium upstairs. Mark started his sermon talking about Leo Beck, who was the first chairman of the committee to speak to the Nazis on behalf of German Jewry. Rabbi Beck stayed right through the war and beyond, and was incarcerated in Theresienstadt, and even after the war finished, he continued on and didn't leave until everything was settled. Mark talked about the rest of us, who spend so much time making a living and doing the best we can. He then offered us the opportunity to be heroic, feeling bound to go beyond ourselves and fulfill ourselves as Jews in the best sense. He wrote, "To the extent that we learn to live for ourselves and yet for more than ourselves, we can be heroic. We can save the boat people. We can offer our hands and our hearts to others who need us in so many ways, every day, everywhere. Through it all, we can save our own sense of worth. We can save our sense of pride in what we stand for and therefore in who we really are." Hanoi had fallen. There was widespread chaos. People were jumping into shark-infested waters to get away. Refugees were leaving any way they could. That very day, Malaysia packed up 76,000 people and shipped them out in leaky boats. They had no place to go. It was just like the Jews of Europe. We had all seen the pictures and heard the stories. Remember the naked, starving, running napalm girl? That's one picture that changed a lot of minds, sort of like the Syrian boy on the beach. One friend of mine, who sponsored a family of four, told the story that an overcrowded ship had been hit by pirates 27 times. They hung up a sign, "No money, no virgins." It didn't help. Barbara Meal, a member of our temple, wrote a very thoughtful article on the topic, which is eerily like today, called Now an Asian Holocaust. I went to the meeting. Dave Hart was there, the Gershons, the Helens, and a few others. We're here tonight. We were told that a family would be arriving very soon. We made a list of things to do and started working. It was quite well organized. I volunteered to look after accommodation. And I might add that we had heard about Professor Edelman and his work, but they were up in the clouds someplace. We were down on the ground. Dave Hart and I got a big old house near Young and Lawrence, cleaned it up, furnished it, and moved them in. My partner Jill was in charge of cleaning. She recalls, and she's a good cleaner too, she recalls wondering why they were going through so much dish soap, only to realize that they had mistaken it for shampoo. Language was a barrier. The family arrived and grew to a dozen or more. I remember a lot of trans who I always got mixed up, so I called them Tran 1, 2, and 3. Some of the older ones seemed quite confused. but they all seemed very happy to be in Canada and grateful. There was lots of trips to do paperwork and get medical attention. The Helens recall taking a bright teenager to Forest Hill Collegiate, just around the corner, to register, and years later going to his wedding. They drove the family out to a pig farm where a King City United Church family had taken in the grandparents. Rabbi Mark talked about the time that he and Stuart Ager went down to Chinatown to get a 50-pound bag of rice, only to find out that Chinatown didn't open early. We all learned a lot about cultures, cross-cultural variation in those days. I look back at some of the temple records. Much like the Syrian crisis today, the federal government and Ron Atkey published a refugee sponsorship program, and Reform Judaism had its own central committee, as well as the temple, which had a large working group. Holy Blossom was always front and center with Harvey Fields on the central committee. There were many references to Professor Edelman in the temple records at that time, who left his island in Georgian Bay, came back, read six weeks worth of papers, and decided to save the world. Thankful for him. Sam Nissenbaum was the chair of the committee, and Max Enkin appeared to write the rules for the board. Unlike the Syrian situation, the U.S. was very strong in supporting the 100 and projected 168,000 families. The number later grew to 500,000, and there was one reference to 750,000 Vietnamese refugees in the United States. Here at Temple, we had 13 groups and sponsored 66 individuals. I faded away from the group over time. Some members, including Dave Hart and his family, stayed in touch for a long time. Murray still does legal work for Tran, who's here tonight. And they ran everything from a dry cleaning business to a convenience store. There was a restaurant in there someplace. University graduates all over the place. And the best thing about the whole thing was that they didn't need us for long. They came over, got a little boost, got a little push. See you later, Charlie. And that's the way it should be. It was a long time ago. Rabbi Splansky also said, bring it forward. What does this mean to me many years later? And you know, I really hadn't thought about it for a long time, except in the context of Syria. I am happy to see that everyone's done so well. And let you know that nobody who ever went on this committee ever wanted any recognition or needed recognition. So the fact that you're giving to us is terrific, but it's not necessary. Number two, I don't recall going to any meetings. So that was one of the best things about it, because all we did was work. And I can also say that I never at any time felt heroic, but was always happy to help. Well, that brings me to the end. But maybe it's just the beginning, because Rabbi also said, what do you want to think about the future? And I know that I, together with the Vietnamese community and many here at the temple, plan to delve into Syria. And I guess it's time for us to all follow Leo Beck's example again. Thank you very much.
By Rabbi Splansky, that you were a young leader back in the days. I think that you're still young. So. And I do apologize for getting your name wrong. It's my fault. My chicken's wrong. I always call my friends that I have the handwriting of a doctor, but I'm not a doctor. And the next person I'm going to introduce to you is an actual MD, a doctor. And he's a very prominent, well-known, well-liked doctor within the Vietnamese community. His name is Koime, and accidentally, not by our volition at all, we didn't plan this, incidentally, Dr. Koi's wife was actually sponsored by David Hartzman. Yes.
Senator, professor, rabbi, thank you for giving me the opportunity to come in to share with you some of my stories. Incidentally, today I actually found out that my wife's family was sponsored to come to Canada by the Holy Temple Blossom. It's a surprise, and on behalf of the family, I'd like to extend our deepest gratitude to the group who has to endure so much for the trans community. Today, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the story of this man. This man, about 35 years ago, when I was in the refugee camp, to this man in New York City. They're both single and available. I left Vietnam in 1979 and in a very small boat. We had over 130 people in a very small boat, and we met pirates, typhoon, hunger, thirst. One of the bad memories that I had at that time was my best friend. She was raped by pirates. And when they pulled her, she looked at me and asked me for help. Never before that I felt so helpless. I froze and I felt like a coward. I could not help her. And then after, when we landed and when we was in the refugee camp, she stopped talking to me and we lost contact. After a few months, I came to Canada and get sponsored. I was very lucky at that time because the Canadian government at that time decided to sponsor a lot of refugees. And I came to Canada depressed, couldn't speak the language, and did not know what to do. I worked as a dishwasher at night and a garbage collector during the day. What I was trying to do at that time was just trying to survive and learn some English. So I went to the library, the metro library, almost daily, trying to find some books and something to read and try to learn English. Because I was so good at, my English was so good at that time, so I decided to pick the smallest book with some very easy things to understand, so I picked a book, and that book changed my life, and I still have that book right now, and it was written by a man, a doctor named Viktor Frankl. I guess a lot of you here knew about the book. And it's just so easy to understand. It's that man's search for meaning. And it was so easy. And I did not understand how come it took me months to read. But after I understood it, it changed my life. It changed completely my life. And I was not sorry for myself. Because at that time, I had a choice. I either be depressed, sad, do nothing, or I become the best dishwasher ever. And I decided to become the best dishwasher. And luckily, it's very funny, because after I became the best dishwasher, things, just very lot of luck. I had a lot of help, a lot of people that helped, and suddenly I got into University of Toronto. And then, somehow, I got to medical school. Maybe they changed the criteria to accept the best dishwasher. And just a tiny note. that I changed my major from philosophy to medicine. Because I actually believe that medicine saves lives. So I had a very nice life, beautiful kids, wives, family. And a few months ago, I began to see pictures that brought back memories that I had. Pictures from people in the small dinghy boats, stories about sinking ships, sinking boats, people died. And I felt that I had to help. And so I really want to help, want to do something. And I know that I want to do things not because I was a refugee, not because I'm Vietnamese, not because I'm a Canadian, but I think I want to help because I am a human being who happens to believe humanity has no borders. And in closing, I'd like to read two sentences, just the last part from the book that I've read so many times. So let us be alert. Alert in the twofold sense. Since Auschwitz, we know what man is capable of. And since Hiroshima, we know what is at stake.
Sister congregation at Bayview and 401. We are a much smaller congregation, 350 families. And we have a very long tradition. Can you hear me?
Okay. You have a beautiful voice.
We have a very long tradition of action at Temple Emmanuel. And a couple of years ago, we published a book, The 50 Years of Social Action at Temple Emmanuel. And there are many projects in this book, but the one I think that we are most proud of and still connect with most closely was the sponsorship of the Vietnamese people. At the time, as you know, everybody saw these horrific pictures in the newspapers, people drowning and hanging off of boats, and everybody felt that we needed to do something. And the government came along and allowed citizens to get involved. And for the first time, we were empowered. And it was an amazing thing that happened. Groups were formed at the temple, and some of them were very loose, and we went out into the community, and that was Howard Adelman who put the groups of people together. In our particular case, we had a group, and we were put in touch with a woman, a non-Jewish woman who lived in our upscale neighborhood, and she called and she said, "I'm a widow, I have a couple of teenage kids, I don't have any money, but I have a house, and I would be prepared to have people live in my house. And so we went to visit, and she had a huge basement that was just ready for renovating, and we got a carpenter, and we put the place together, and we put in a kitchen, and we welcomed our family. A small the Ta family, who are here tonight, Hai and Wei, and their 9-month-old daughter, Tam Yen. And I have to tell you that we attended Tam Yen's wedding, and they are here tonight with their son Peter, who was born here after they arrived, and his daughter. So it's wonderful to see everybody here tonight.
And I, up.
Pardon?
You should stand up.
Well, they should stand up. But the story that I'm going to tell is they were here for a few months. We could only speak with an interpreter. And they were happy to be here, but very concerned because Hui's family was still in a refugee camp in Hong Kong. And could we bring their family? I have to tell you, there were a dozen of them, the Liu family. And at the time that they asked, I said, I don't think so. I don't think that's how it works. The government gave us a family. I don't think that you can say that's the family that we want. But one of the women in our group had a nephew who worked in Ottawa, somewhere in your office, who had said, you know, if I can ever do anything to help. And so she called him, and he said, oh, Aunt Joan, I don't, how could you do anything? I couldn't. Please, you have to try. I have to tell you that in a month's time, we went to the airport and picked up the dozen people. The phrase that I have always used was, it was like the hand of God came down and plucked those people out and brought them here. And there are two members of the Liu family here tonight. And Howard said, we're a small congregation. We sponsored 100 people, and it's probably the best thing that we ever did at Temple Emmanuel. Thank you.
First off, I'd like to say doing this is actually more nerve-wracking than being out of this, skiing in front of thousands of people. So please forgive me if I made a few mistakes, but hopefully not. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you all for letting me come up here and speak about my father, who is a Vietnamese boat refugee. I am so lucky. I have so much to say about my strong Liu parents. Growing up, my dad has told me a few stories when he escaped Vietnam and came to Canada. And at first, I didn't believe him because some of them were like over the top and really scary. But when I learned more about this whole subject, the Vietnamese boat refugee, I started to believe him. And I appreciated what he has done for me in my life. I'm so lucky to be born in Canada and be raised by my wonderful father and my mother, and also with my little sister. The theme of this story, the stories that my father has told me, is all about strong will and passion. Going through the process that he has done was not easy. It was definitely not easy. And this was not possible without the Jewish Canadian community helping us restart, find a better life outside from their home country, which is Canada. And it's amazing. So when my dad teaches me about these things, he shares with me the strong will and the passion in life and in figure skating. And I know for sure that without my father and my mother teaching me these things, I wouldn't be able to accomplish what I have today. My major achievements are winning nationals earlier this year, and also last year I'm 2014 junior world champion. It's difficult. Figure skating is a very hard sport, and it's all about mentality and also the physical aspects too. My father, he's my psychologist, unofficial psychologist, but I prefer him over anyone else, definitely. And some of the things that he's taught me are, I will admit, a little bit unorthodox to other individuals in the sport, but for me, it works. I'm strong. I'm confident in every single competition, and this is all because of the stories and experiences that my dad has shared with me. And I just like to say thank you to my wonderful family, my mom and my dad, for helping me get through the hardest times in my life. And I know for sure that even when I'm the strongest in my life, it will not compare to what my father and my mother have during the process coming from Vietnam to Canada. And once again, I'd like to thank the Jewish community for their assistance, their support, and also the Vietnamese Canadian community for supporting my family and helping me to accomplish and achieve my dreams and goals. And lastly, my family for their love and support. And in 2018, I wish to win the Olympic gold medal, and it will be dedicated to you all. Thank you.
Triumph,
We share the stories of our past. We're sharing stories about our present. But most importantly, we are sharing what we're going to do in the future to help those in need. Vietnamese Canadian for Lifeline Syria has a mission of sponsoring at least 3 to 4 families, and our goal is to raise at least 100,000. Since October 3rd, we have raised close to 60,000, and we're on our way to sponsoring those families.
Thank you.
Professor Simmons, we here with you, and we heard that you had helped a lot in the Lifeline operation in 1979, 1980,
right,
to sponsor a lot of Vietnamese to arrive to Canada.
Yes.
And could you share with us some of your experience back then?
Well, we were really here helping the Jewish community to become involved in this whole important enterprise. And it was, you know, I was just, you know, a young member of the congregation, but I was very much involved in social justice, so I was encouraging and trying to get people here. And I think, you know, as you saw tonight, I think that the Reform Jewish community really has learned a lot from bringing the Vietnamese here, seeing them and seeing, you know, that, you know, we have a responsibility for people all over the world.
So when they arrive, what do you have to provide? Like, do you bring them to the church and helping them at beginning with?
Well, you know, I think they became, you know, when the time they came, you know, we had families, you know, who were reaching out to them and helping them. And you heard some of those stories this evening, you know, of how they got involved with them. And so when, you know, it was not just this congregation, as I tried to say, but it was, you know, many congregations that came together and took on something, you know, that they had never done before. And it was, as I said, you know, an attempt to realize that one of the foundation points of Jews is to be there trying to make it a better world to live in.
Thank you very much, Professor. And I'm wondering, what are your feeling tonight when you meet some of them that you had worked with and you had a chance to, you know, like, reach? So.
Oh, it was an incredible evening. It was just very moving, and I really do hope that we make a movie or a video that we could show, you know, other congregations and other communities, you know, about this. I mean, because the whole event was just so moving and exciting. So I think we really have to thank you for having organized this evening, this tonight, and it's something that, you know, I really am sorry that my wife wasn't here. He was teaching tonight and she couldn't come, but it was just an incredible event, and that's why I do hope that others can see it and feel
it. Thank you so much, Professor, and hopefully when we got the video, we will show it to you. Thưa quý vị khán giả, bên cạnh Diễm Hương là Nam Nguyễn, người rất là nổi tiếng trong cộng đồng chúng ta, đã đạt được nhiều thành tích trong ngành trực ban nghệ thuật. Và Diễm Hương xin hỏi Nam in English, tại tiếng Anh, tại vì Nam born ở đây, thành ra tiếng Việt có lẽ không hiểu rõ. Hi Nam, could you share with us your most recent tournaments or medalists?
Earlier this season in January, I won the gold medal at our Canadian Nationals. So I am the reigning 2015 Canadian National Champion.
Một cái thành tích lớn như vậy, em mất bao nhiêu thời gian để chuẩn bị?
I've sacrificed a lot of time for this sport, especially in school. Regular students go to school from 8 o'clock to 3 o'clock. I'm able to go to school from 10 o'clock to 12 o'clock so that I'm able to train and achieve my goals.
So what will be your next step?
My next step is to represent Canada at the World Championships in Boston in 2016. And in my long-term goals, I would love to represent Canada at the 2018 Olympic Winter Games in Pyeongchang, South Korea, and also win it.
So who's your current trainer?
My coach is Brian Orser.
So do you always train with him, or you have a plan? Like you have a second trainer as well?
Right now I have two coaches. My first coach is Brian Orser, and my second coach is Ernest Prihitka.
So in order for you to keep doing it, like, what grade are you in right now, school?
I am in grade 12 right now.
So this is a lot of work.
Yeah.
And you have to prepare for university as well as your training.
Yes, exactly. Right now it's very busy with the courses that I have at school and also the preparation process for university.
So how do you manage to do that?
I usually train in the mornings, and then I go to school, and then I come back and train more in the afternoon, and then in the evening I find some time to complete my work and do anything that's related to school.
Because of your achievement, would your teachers consider give you a little extension in your homework or assignments?
Yes, and that is what I'm grateful for. I would like to thank my teachers for their support for me and their understanding of my busy schedule and allowing me to hand in my assignments a little bit later than the deadline.
For you to apply to university, all your achievement in your sport, would it help to get in the university of your choice, would you think?
To be honest, I am not exactly sure. I haven't exactly looked into the universities yet, but hopefully some of them do count towards it.
So what would you like to be, though?
I would love to be a coach or a sports medicine doctor. It's been my dream since I was 8 years old, and I'm continuing to work towards that goal.
Thank you very much, Nam, and I wish you all your best. And you know, we look forward to hear all the good news from you.
Từ miền trùng xa, ai vẫn hát vang lời Việt Nam.
Buổi gặp gỡ với giáo sư Edelman và giáo sư Simmons cùng với một số người bảo trợ diễn ra rất là cảm động trong cái sự hồi tưởng với một số những kỷ niệm vui buồn của những ngày đầu tị nạn, khiến chúng ta, những người có mặt ở đây, đều cảm xúc. Cảm ơn tất cả quý vị đã theo dõi buổi phóng sự của chúng tôi. Diễm Hương chúc quý vị một buổi tối bình an.